r/AskReddit. Former neo-Nazis members of hate groups. What was your I need to get the hell out of here moment? My uncle was part of the KKK. He was very poor and homeless, and the KKK supplies you with housing and food and pays for things for you. But he tried quitting, and one day as he left a bar, he was jumped by members and had his chest slit open. He had to get around 200 staples, but he still quit. Thankfully, I started to get older and learn more compassion. I was a lonely kid and I didn't have many friends. And I already grew up in a racist household, and many of my family members are neo-Nazis, covered with white supremacy tattoos. I discovered a group of older skinhead kids and I fell into it pretty bad, as I was learning more compassion and slowly was shedding my neo-Nazi beliefs. My buddies were bragging that they beat the duck out of another mutual friend of ours when he said he wasn't a Nazi anymore and he was dating a black chick. I was already thinking about leaving the group. It was basically a little gang. Once I found out they were beating up people for leaving, I realized it really was like a gang and I didn't want anything to do with it. I was shedding my racism and I didn't want to be involved. So I thought if I was a piece of shit enough to be a Nazi in the first place, I deserved to get beat up anyway, and if getting beat up meant I could get away for a life away from Nazism, then that was good enough for me. I've still been a neo-Nazi for longer than I've been an anti-Nazi, but I'm looking forward to the day I can say I've been an anti-Nazi for longer than I've been one. I have an acquaintance who works to help reform Nazis in Germany. According to her, a lot of people leave the movement not because they've had a change of heart, but because their lives have been threatened by their fellow Nazi friends. And since a lot of them have alienated their families and have no one to turn to for support or community, they will often end up in these formal, government-sponsored reform programs. She said that even though a drastic political shift might not be the catalyst for a person to join the program works with individuals over long stretches of time and with the aim of slowly shifting their views through mandated therapy and such. She said she's definitely seen some success stories, but has also seen some people who never quite have that change of heart. Not me, but my grandfather evidently was a member of either the Klan or associated hate group back in the 1960s. He became a born-again Christian and walked away from it. There was little evidence of his history as I grew up. I only found out after my mother told me about it after he passed away. My dad was a KKK member and I became a neo-Nazi skinhead at the age of 14. Because it was acceptable rebellion, i.e., I could be a teenager but not risk getting kicked or upsetting my parents too bad. At 18, I married a former Klansman who also had ties to a neo-Nazi group I was in. We bounced between various groups for about a decade after the main neo-Nazi group split, including a year or two where we were both on the state board of the local KKK. There were times I thought about leaving and was having second thoughts, in part because of hypocrisy and how most racists we knew lived and behaved worse than they stereotyped other races as doing, and in part because of growing misogyny in the larger racist movement. But I was worried about losing all my friends and my family if I did. Being an open racist isn't really constructive to making or keeping friends who are not also racist. The final straw was twofold. I was pregnant and didn't want to raise my son that way because overall it made our lives worse. Plus I connected with a few people in online pregnancy groups without knowing their race and found that one woman I related to the most was black and married to a white man. My husband had also come out as bisexual and, during my pregnancy, had told me he was possibly transgender. He had dating profiles online stating this and I was worried some of our friends would literally kill him if they found out. Long ago, buddy of mine quit the Klan after just barely not getting his head taken off by a .44 mag. He and his fellas were in their trucks driving along, and saw a truck driving through what they thought of as their town. Said truck had a black guy driving, and another in the passenger's seat. Being the kind of fellas they were, they took exception to this and gave chase. Hooting, hollering, threatening to run the truck off the road, etc. As my friend was leaning out his window to yell some nonsense, the passenger in the truck they were chasing opted to instill a sense of caution in the good old boys via a Ruger. My friend saw the pistol come out, had that moment of dread, saw the muzzle drop ever so slightly, and the side mirror on his truck vanished. He realized how close he'd come to death for what suddenly seemed like a very silly reason. Within a few months he was quietly packing up and leaving town. cutting pretty much all his social ties permanently. My niece in Romania married a neo-Nazi last year, or at least we thought he was because of his long Facebook history, racist tattoos, prior arrest for hooliganism, etc. I had a 4-hour car ride with him and had a long chat. He quit because he left the Romania for a little while to work in Amsterdam. His co-workers were from all over the world, including African countries and Israel. He realized everyone was pretty much the same after drinking with them and smoking a joint after work. There was nothing about them worth hating. They were doing the same thing he was. He basically quit Facebook and started getting his tats modified, and hasn't touched politics at all since 3 or 4 years. Travel is fatal to prejudice, bigotry, and narrow-mindedness, and many of our people need it sorely on these accounts. Broad, wholesome, charitable views of men and things cannot be acquired by vegetating in one little corner of the earth all one's lifetime. This is long, but I'm putting it out there. This was 30 years ago. I've probably only told this story 3 times in those years. It wasn't organized into anything identifiable as a group. It was more a large number of like-minded individuals living in the same North Alabama area. We all hated blacks. Weekend nights were spent at a few local bars surrounded by people talking about how some men had done something stupid or how they'd run in off the road. You get wrapped up in that echo chamber. It's all you hear. The little things that happen between races start to seem like major trends. I went from being a guy who went to one of those bars as a joke, to making friends with people there, to having them and that attitude become part of my life. I lived that life. I was that guy. You want to fit in, so you find your own stories to share. You start subconsciously seeking out anything that supports the racial stereotypes that fit the narrative of the group. You find huge fault with the minor things that make us different. Those people accepted me. They were my support group, my pseudo-family. Almost my entire social circle was made of people who hated every other race. We had some amazing times together. Huge loving Christmas gatherings, vacations, hunting trips. It's not like everything we did was centered around racism. It was just an underlying theme that would come out every now and then. I celebrated at weddings, cried at funerals, and danced when babies were born. I was in church with these people on Sundays. I helped build 2 Habitat for Humanity houses with people from that group. And we even raised money to help a local black family that had lost everything in a house fire. I think every group, everywhere, has a unifying thing that ties them together. This large group of people just happened to feel superior to black people. They didn't actively go out and do violent, evil things. They didn't all fly Confederate flags and spew hate. Most of them worked peacefully with black folks. Most of them were willing to help out black folks who had met with something bad. They just all felt that their skin color inherently made them superior. ==. Then there was one night that changed everything for me. There were a couple of dozen people hanging out around a bonfire behind a bar, and I was listening to this guy I really didn't like go on a drunken rant about how white people and black people were different. He'd scream they all sell drugs, and I'd think, well, so do you, dumbass. They are all on welfare. He was living on disability scam checks. They are all a bunch of thieves, coming from someone who have been to jail several times for stealing materials from construction sites. I quite literally sat on a log around that fire and had a moment of enlightenment. His rant was almost like a voiceover where everything he said, or everything someone jokingly added, immediately made me look at who in that group was guilty of exactly what they were shading someone else with. I looked at these friends, these people I'd shared 100 meals and a 1,000 beers with, and saw them all completely differently. There was nobody there I actually wanted to be around anymore. 10 minutes earlier I'd seen them as practically family. I can't really describe it. It was like they all changed. Physically changed. The longer I looked at them, the more they morphed. They were no longer those good old heart of the country people I'd loved. They were all ignorant. Their entire body of knowledge was little more than passed down excuses and cliches. None of them were actually contributing anything to society. They weren't making the world a better place. They were doing nothing except figuring out how to keep someone under them so they didn't have to be the bottom of society. They were exactly what they said every other race was. I was physically sick when the girl I'd been dating came over. I looked at her and instead of the cute chubby little country girl I'd shown up with, she was just the spawn of generations of stupidity. She was as sweet as she could be. She treated me like a hero. And her family loved me. All I could see when I looked at her was every throwaway bigoted comment she'd ever made. Every time she'd rolled her eyes at a black cashier. Every snarky comment at the Chinese buffet. She had never done a thing wrong to me and I've never felt a need to get away from someone so fast in my life. It was like I knew she was an anchor and if I stayed with her I'd forever be one of these people. I'll never have the words to explain what those people looked like when I was leaving. They had all changed. I left that night and never looked back. I talked to the girl one time because she tracked me down at work and I promised I was okay. My head was just all messed up, and I needed a little time alone. I called my mom, told her I needed to move home, 90 miles away, and by Friday I had ghosted that entire place and everyone in it. I was raised by white supremacists who were active in the movement in Canada. It occurred when I was 15 when I pretty much stopped just accepting that my parents were right on everything. And talking to my grandfather at the right time of my life. Telling me how he ended up in Canada because his brother outed him as a communist and he had to run. I remember how in the hell does a communist raise a fascist? He said he could only give his children his morals and what he thought is right and wrong. But once they were adults, they were responsible for figuring the rest out, and that just as my mother rejected what he tried to impart on her, I could do the same. Wasn't actually a member, but when I saw that someone I used to be friends with trying to indoctrinate, I got curious and asked for evidence, sources, etc. A lot of their sources for stuff like race equals predisposed behavior and Holocaust denial are usually either related to statistics that are really easy to be faked. I get the duck out of there, but the psychology of how people get sucked into that type of stuff fascinates me. Edit. Forgot to mention this, but a lot of the propaganda in those movements revolves around the idea that all other races and demographics hate you is extremely prevalent. I'm white and my husband is black. My dad is a very old school Southern Green Beret who always told me that I was not to date outside my race. My dad got deployed all over and was very much absent for my senior year of high school until a couple years into college. When I finally talked to him, he found out I was attending FAMU, a historically black university, and the first thing he said was, "You're not dating a black guy, are you?" But I was. In fact, I had been with him for years at that point. We were only together for a few months when he put his life on hold to work 5 jobs to help put me through college. My dad was incredibly angry and he essentially disowned me. Years later he met my husband, who was my fiancé at that time, and after talking with him for about a half an hour, my big, scary, racist dad burst into hysterics and apologized profusely. It was like switch flipped while he was talking with my fiancé and he realized that he was the a-hole and he just kept apologizing. It was shocking, honestly, and something I won't ever forget. It's been almost 10 years since that day and he still apologizes and is trying to make up for it. My grandma says the reason her father, my great-grandpa, the nicest man I'd ever met in my life, left the KKK in Oklahoma was because a few of the older male members were starting to get handsy with the young daughters of the other members. These kids were under 10 years old and a couple men were caught with hands-up dresses. According to grandma, he told the group he'd rather be surrounded by a bunch of NS than spend one more minute among the company of child perverts. Apparently even racists have a line in the sand. We still have the letter from they sent him in 1924 summoning him back to answer questions. When I fell for a black girl, I think I was trying to fit in and be cool by being involved with people like that instead of actually being racist. I needed somewhere to fit in. Completely off topic. I once knew a colorblind racist. He was born completely colorblind. And he once made me laugh way too hard, because he said this in a most serious tone. "All you grays look the same." Made me laugh. Still does. Ro, you made it to the end? You're a ducking beast. I'll cuss you a deal. Smash like and subscribe for more curated content, mate. It's free and that's a great price.